Good morning. Welcome everyone to the 15th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee, which we are conducting remotely this week. We have apologies from Natalie Dawn. Colette Stevenson will once again be in attendance as committee substitute. At agenda item one, we have consideration of whether to take agenda items 3 and 4 in private. Item 3 is consideration of the evidence heard this morning. And item 4 is consideration of the committee's work programme. Are we all agreed? That is agreed. Thank you very much. Items 3 and 4 will be taken in private. Our main business this morning is an evidence session with the UK Climate Change Committee in relation to its annual progress report to the Scottish Parliament, which was published on the 7th of December. This is the 10th annual progress report to the Scottish Parliament as required by the Climate Change Scotland Act 2009. The report presents 70 key recommendations to support Scotland's transition to net zero and highlights that the focus in Scotland must now be to ensure the rapid emission reduction in order to deliver and to meet Scotland's legislated 2030 targets. To discuss the report, I welcome our panel, Chris Stark, Chief Executive, Climate Change Committee, and Professor Keith Bell, Scottish Member, Climate Change Committee. Thank you both for accepting the invitation to attend the committee this morning, and thank you for your ongoing support to the Scottish Parliament. Mr. Stark, I understand that you would like to make a short opening statement, so I will pass over to you, and you will see that your microphone will be enabled by broadcasting.
Thanks so much, convener, and it's very good to see you all this morning. I'm sorry that we have to do it remotely, but we are where we are, sadly. This is the 10th assessment that we've offered of the Scottish Government's efforts to cut greenhouse gas emissions under the Scottish Climate Change Act, and I'm very privileged to continue to provide that service for the Scottish Parliament. Keith and I are with you today, and a few opening words from us, really, just to sort of set the scene for the report. Over the years that we've been providing these reports, we've tended to be fairly generous in our assessment of the climate plans from Scottish ministers. Around the table at the CCC, we always have a choice, I suppose, about how we describe the state of play, and crucially, I suppose, what degree of optimism we should bring to the chances of future success. And in general, we want to try and encourage and to highlight the positives. And I don't mind saying it's always been quite useful to be able to point to the Scottish plans as a spur to other parts of the UK to do similar things. But members might have noticed a change in tone in this assessment. That's deliberate. This year we have had the Scottish parliamentary election. That's returned a different sort of government with Greens and SNP together. This is the first time that we have felt that we needed to offer such clear criticism of the state of play of climate policy in Scotland. And I wanted to mention that because it's not because I or the committee feel that there is any change in the political commitment behind Scotland's climate plans. It's because we're running out of time to turn the great promises that we've seen from ministers into a change in the real world. And I'm afraid that's just the reality of the situation that Scotland now faces under this climate legislation that we have. So it's this parliamentary term that will really matter. This is the parliament that will really have to change the weather, I suppose, when it comes to the state of play on climate. The next parliament's going to be too late. And we make the point in several places in this report that Scotland took 30 years to more or less halve its emissions. It's going to halve them again in less than 10. If we're going to meet that 2030 target that Parliament set for the country. Now, I'm on record on talking about how hard that target is. It wasn't on the path that we advised. It is more ambitious than any scenario that we have yet created. But the time for questioning that target from our perspective is now over. It's law. It has to be met. And at the moment, we have doubts that it will be met, despite the raft of new policies and strategies that have come from the Scottish Government. So, that's the serious point, I suppose, I wanted to make to kick us off. All of this is potentially going to place the Scottish climate change target framework in jeopardy if it doesn't change. And in our view, most of the levers to change it lie now with Scottish ministers. Even where they don't, there is a need, I think, to find ways to achieve consensus cooperation with UK ministers so that we can address that. So We've made that conscious decision, Convener, to be tougher about where we need to see progress in the support. But I did just want to say at the top of this, it's because of the numbers. That's what's led us to that change of tone rather than any change in our view about the political commitment.
Many thanks, Chris. Those opening remarks set the scene well, and I'm sure members will have questions to follow up. So let me start with the first question. As you well know, one of the main responsibilities of this committee is to scrutinise the implementation of Scottish Government policy in this area. So it would be very helpful if you could elaborate on some of the committee's observations about clarity, transparency and detail on policy, which has been lacking, and that, as you just said, the credibility of the Scottish climate framework is in jeopardy. There have been a number of headline policy announcements in recent years which might fall into this category, including the announcement of the publicly owned energy company that didn't materialise, the Public Energy Agency, which we understand is going to be a virtual-only agency. There's concern over a lack of detail in the heat and buildings strategy and the absence of plans surrounding the target to reduce car miles by 20%. Are these the type of policy announcements you're concerned with in terms of the need for more detail, the need for more specific targets and better implementation, as well as, I think you raised in the report, the critical question of how all of this is going to be financed?
Well, yes, I think they are, and Keith might want to come in after I say a few opening comments about that. But I mean, broadly, what we see in the various statements from the Scottish Government, and by that I mean the climate change plan update, the programme for government, and possibly also the most recent draft budget that we've seen from the Scottish Government, what we can see is a collection of policies, proposals, commitments that, if you add them up, do amount to an incredibly ambitious programme. There's no doubt about that. Since the publication, particularly of the climate change plan update, we've seen a collection of new policies announced, and what we haven't yet been able to do is to match those up with emissions reductions, the numbers, and we haven't quite been able to understand how, you know, various funding commitments that have been made are tied to those policy commitments. And I think probably the hardest thing for us, given that we have the statutory role in assessing progress, is that what we have in the climate change plan update is a set of sectoral pathways for Scottish emissions across the various sectors of the Scottish economy. You know, you can see the path that is intended by the climate change plan update, and it's incredibly ambitious, as it needs to be to meet these statutory targets that I mentioned in my opening statement. But we can't match that with the policies themselves. So we can't quite see how that pathway will be delivered by the announced policies, nor whether those policies are fully funded to be delivered. And I think I might add in a further point, which is that we know that a lot of this will have to be delivered by the private sector. We would say the majority of the progress will need to be made by private investment, by individuals, by corporates making decisions and investing. It's not entirely clear how that process of change will take place either through these policies that I've mentioned. So it's not to say that it can't be done, and I genuinely admire the ambition of Scottish ministers in the various publications that we've seen on climate. It's very clear that the theme of climate runs right the way through the recent Scottish budget. But it's not clear how that pathway that actually will deliver the emissions targets that are now law in Scotland can be delivered through those policies. Keith, I don't know whether you want to add anything.
Yeah, thanks, and good morning, everyone. I think you're right. It's the level of detail now about delivery and in achieving the outcomes that are promised. So the outcomes that are intended are, you know, fantastic, you know, and that's the level of ambition that you know, absolutely welcome. So how do you get from here to there is obviously the big question. There's been a raft of, Chris said, a raft of kind of consultations, but we still seem to largely be in that consultation space rather than the testing out of the mechanisms for delivery and then the achievement of outcomes. Now, one of the things that I think is good is the kind of greater detail that is now promised in, for example, an annual monitoring report. And, you know, that's going to enable us to achieve some of this kind of oversight that Chris was mentioning. But if you look through a lot of that monitoring report now, a lot of it is saying the data is still to be collected, or there are processes still to be put in place to collect the data. Now, those processes and the collection of data is a very boring activity. You know, if it's you who's got to do it, you're not going to be very happy about it. But it's absolutely crucial to understand where we are, and then as policies hopefully begin to be rolled out, are they having the impact that we need to get to? So, you know, it's just another illustration, really, of the kind of challenge of getting into that space of delivery.
Thank you very much, Chris and Keith, for those answers. Chris, you mentioned the vital need to finance all of these policies, and I think if you look at the heat and building strategy, it's clear that the majority of finance is going to have to come from the private sector. If there is some concern over the credibility of the climate framework in Scotland and the credibility of policy framework, does that lead to a concern that the ability to bring in the necessary huge amount of private sector finance is also going to be in jeopardy?
Yes, I think that's a legitimate criticism. I think it's important to say that when we look across the challenge of reaching net zero, let's just talk about net zero and step away from the immediate challenge of the 2030 targets. We, in our assessment of Scotland's goal of reaching net zero, have said that it is mainly an investment challenge. So, in effect, we are investing in capital assets across the economy in every sector, not just in new wind farms, but also in new electric cars or new heat pumps or new plant and machinery in business. These are the assets that at present we use, which burn fossil fuels, which then create the problem of climate change. Our investment is turning over the capital stock of this economy, something that is zero carbon. It is a major challenge. Much of that investment will need to be led by the public sector, but most of it will be investments made by individuals or by corporates, which over time lead us to the goal of net zero. And we've put a number on that for the UK of between 50 and 60 billion pounds of extra investment each year from about 2030 onwards. For Scotland, we've also put a number on that of between 5 and 6 billion. And so that's the annual investment requirement to get us to net zero over the course of the next 25 years or so. And much of that, as I mentioned, will be led by private investment. But crucially, I think this is the really important thing here, the work that we've done and others has said that there's no shortage of capital and finance out there to allow that to take place. What we need is a path for that wall of capital that is out there to reach the real world. And that's the policy mechanism. We need policies that allow that finance to flow. Some of it will be directly done by the government. So think about some of the major infrastructure that we might do, for example, to decarbonise the rail system. That is going to be a piece of investment that's done directly by the government. But much of it will be done by individuals or by individual corporates. So think about that challenge, for example, of decarbonising heat that you mentioned, Convener. The Scottish Government has a plan for that. They're talking about installing many hundreds of thousands of heat pumps, which is an electrical technology that allows us to decarbonise the supply of heat over the course of the next 10, 15, 20 years. Most of that will be done by individuals, but we haven't quite understood yet what combination of regulation or support or even law will allow that finance to flow. I don't doubt that it can be done, but that's the challenge, is to turn that into a set of policies that give me confidence that will happen. And the final point I'll make is that this is the importance of the Climate Change Act, from my perspective, is that it gives confidence to the whole collection of actors in the economy that we are on this journey and that we will deliver it. And that's the importance of the statutory targets. They are not a guide, they are law. So if everyone has confidence that they will be met, and if everyone understands that they have a set of roles to play in that process that will take place over the next 20, 25 years, then I'm confident it will be done. And I'm confident it will be done in a way that is low cost to the economy and achieves the goals that the Climate Change Act sets out to do. If that framework is loosened, if we start to view these things as, you know, more of a signal rather than a law, then you get the sense that, you know, all the actors in this process I've just described will start to have doubts. And that's when the costs come in, because it's talking raw finance terms. That's a cost of capital issue. As the risk increases, so does the cost of financing. So I think it's important to say all this at the moment, because this is the decade when we're going to have to make the big progress to achieve all of this. And it really, really does matter that the overall cost of this will be kept low if we keep the risk of failing these targets low as well.
Absolutely. The numbers you mentioned in terms of annual expenditure are massively significant. Before I bring in other members, let me follow up with a brief question in another area, because this committee is about to embark on a major inquiry into the role of local government and cross-sector partners in delivering net zero. I'm sure you've heard concerns expressed over whether local government has the necessary resources available, the necessary budget and expertise to deliver everything that has been asked of local government, especially in the context of the latest budget, where we've seen a real-term decline in the local government settlement. Do you share these concerns about the capacity? And it's in no way a criticism of local government, because they have done a great job during the pandemic, but their resources are very stretched. Do you share these concerns about the capacity of local government to deliver on all the fronts they're being required to?
I do share those concerns. I think you used a good word there, which was capacity. So there are two challenges here. There are resources, not typically a financial issue, and there's also the capacity issue. And I think both of those are a challenge here, because what we're asking in this, you know, grand design that we are trying to bring together of how to decarbonize a whole economy is a new set of requirements from local government. From my perspective, some of the most interesting challenges lie at that level. And you could think about it in this way. Every town, village, city in Scotland has to really have its own distinctive plan for decarbonising, because every town, city or village is different in Scotland. So I'm speaking to you today from my kitchen in Glasgow. All around me is Glasgow's very distinctive Glasgow tenements. I'm in one of them today. A town, a city like Glasgow needs to have a distinctive plan for decarbonising. It's got to have its own plan for transport as well. It's going to have its own plan for making these kind of buildings more energy efficient. I could go on. The jobs that will be here will be distinctive as well. I think it's really, really important that local government has some ownership of those issues and some agency to define that plan. And I think that is primarily a capacity issue, because that is not the typical thing that we might have expected local government to do, say, 5-10 years ago if we were talking about this. For me, that's really exciting, because if local government has that agency and capacity, then I think that's probably the key to unlocking a set of really meaningful plans that will stick. But if we don't have that, if that capacity isn't there, and the resource question now comes in as well, if the resources aren't available, then it becomes hard to push this from the centre. So the Scottish Government may well have a plan, but you're pushing bits of string unless you've got bits of government that are ready for that. So again, I think we have time to fix that. But it is important to say that local government has a very important role in this, and they need to be helped and supported to build that capacity.
Yeah, well, I just add to that it's not to say that I totally agree with everything that Chris has said, but it's not to say that the local government has to do absolutely everything, but they have a really important kind of role in terms of reconciling different dimensions of the challenge, and of kind of coordinating and of bringing, you know, important other actors together. So I'm very glad that your inquiry is not only about local government, but local government is a crucial kind of, you know, glue, if you like, that takes account of those, as Chris was saying, the kind of particular differences in different locations.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks very much, Keith and Chris. These are all issues we'll be exploring in that inquiry, which begins early in the new year. I see that Mark Ruskell has a supplemental in this area, and then I'll bring in Fiona Hislop. Mark, over to you.
Yeah, thanks. Morning to you both. I suppose I was going to ask you, in relation to the cooperation agreement between the government, which areas you think substantial progress has been made? And that's notwithstanding your comments about now is a time to build that delivery and to make sure that the budgets and the detail is there for delivery. But are there particular themes where you think progress is being made?
I'm happy to pick that up. Keith will have his own views, I'm sure. But the first thing to say is I think it's great that we have a Scottish Cabinet that has a Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero. And I think it's also great that we have ministerial portfolios that are very clearly tied to that climate challenge, the transition to net zero, Minister for Green Skills, Circular Economy and Biodiversity. That's a very important title, and a Minister for Zero Carbon Buildings, Active Travel and Tenants' Rights. and a Minister for the Just Transition, Employment and Fair Work. Now, I think that is a reflection of the change in priorities. I thought carefully about what to say at the start of this meeting, because I don't want to remove the optimism that I have from this discussion, because I think it is really good that these ministerial portfolios are in place. And it is very clear from my perspective that that is already having some important, that's really an important impact. And it's probably most obvious in the housing space and most obvious in the transport space, where we've got these big packages of spending now to decarbonise buildings in Scotland, and big packages of spending and priority being given to things like active travel, really for the first time. So I suppose all of that is great. The other thing I might chuck into the mix here, which I'm not sure is a product of the SNP and Green agreement or not, but it's still worth commenting on, is the really commendable focus that's been brought to what's called the just transition or the fair transition, and the various aspects of that, but particularly of workers and skills, presumably because of the challenge in the oil and gas sector in Scotland. But I think there's a wider collection of issues here that Scotland is now leading on, and I would like to see other parts of the UK follow suit. So all of that is pointing in a better direction for me. But back to my opening comments, that now needs to be turned into real-world change on the ground, and the clock is ticking. This isn't something that I'm afraid we have another decade to think about. We've got to turn this in this year into something that is, you know, making real-world progress on emissions. And I think that's the challenge for me. It's great to see that shift in focus and emphasis that has come through these new ministerial positions. I'm sure that the arrangement with the Greens, between the Greens and the SNP, will bear fruit. It's got to do so very, very quickly.
Thanks very much, Mark. Let me bring in Fiona Hislop. Fiona.
Good to see you both. Thank you for joining us. Given the risk to meeting the tough 2030 75% reduction target, a cross-party collective decision in the Scottish Parliament, in which sectors are rapid gains still feasible, and what needs to change to deliver tangible reductions in these areas? I know you set this out in detail in your recent report, but I'm keen to hear from both of you what focus and emphasis you want to give this committee. So first of all, can I come to Chris Stark, and then I'll come to Professor Chris.
Thank you very much. It's a very, very good question, because we're already in the decade now that will matter in determining whether we meet the 2030 target or not. And the 2030 target is really difficult, as we've talked about many, many times before. But just to make the point again, that time for discussing and debating that target has passed, I think. So the challenge is now in meeting it. And it is going to be tough to meet, because the flexibility that we have is not great. We already have a plan from the Scottish Government that effectively turns the dial up to 11 in a host of areas. So there's not much scope to go faster on that plan in most areas. I think for me that the big areas that will matter are whether we can capture some kind of emissions benefit still from the whatever remains of the pandemic impact. So that probably means looking to post-pandemic, trying to reduce our use of road travel, and potentially, as much as it's possible to do so, working from home, capturing the benefit emission in emissions terms from that. And then the other one, which I'm afraid we haven't heard very much at all from Scottish ministers on, is whether we can suppress future growth in aviation demand. These are kind of collection of transport areas where I think you could probably go further. And the other area that we've highlighted, which is still, I think, a bit of a mystery to me, actually, but one in most areas, as you would expect, since the advice that we've given was for a less strenuous target by 2030, you see that the Scottish Government has gone ahead of the CCC's ambition by 2030 in most areas. One area where they haven't is in industry, so industrial emissions. So that might be another area where there is some scope to raise ambitions still further. A lot of the policy there does rest on UK-wide policy making, particularly around some of the energy policies that will matter for industry. But I still think there's scope to do more there. So, you know, that might be something that the committee wants to look further at.
Thank you. And Professor Bell, do you want to comment?
it's all a big challenge. And, you know, like Chris said, obviously he's, you know, watched Spinal Tap a few times, so he's turning it up to 11 on everything. But things take time, and this is where, you know, we're a little bit behind the curve in terms of defining the mechanisms that kind of give confidence to the investment that Chris talked about earlier. So, for example, you know, in the buildings, in terms of changing people's heating systems, there's one positive that I think we should hold on to, which is recognition that, and again, Chris touched on this, that the housing stock is diverse. You know, not all of us live in the same kinds of buildings. So just as some of them are going to be very difficult to convert, you know, the kind of terms of the energy efficiency, the insulation, the means of getting heat around the building could be quite expensive to convert. Others are going to be easier to convert and, you know, maybe kind of relatively straightforward to improve the insulation so that you can have a kind of a low temperature distribution system with okay, maybe with bigger radiators, but, you know, kind of not so bad in terms of fitting with a heat pump. So by recognizing the diversity across the housing stock, we can, in theory, get on with the easier stuff. But that still depends on enough people and with the right skills to be able to do it. So that's another thing that kind of, you know, kind of building things up. And it has to come hand in hand. The demand for these kinds of skills, along with the provision of these kinds of skills. You know, no one's going to take on the burden of going and doing an FE college course, you know, taking extra time or perhaps limiting their kind of the amount of time they can spend earning money in the short term, unless they're confident that the business is going to be there in the medium to long term. So just as that confidence issue is there for sort of large scale investors that we might immediately have in mind, when we talk about that, it's also there for, you know, individuals in terms of their own, you know, career development. But so there's kind of mixed of positive and negative there. The positives is that there's harder stuff, there's easier stuff that in theory we could be getting on with, relatively speaking. But that's still got to be facilitated by various other sorts of measures, I think.
Thank you. And with the 2030 target, the original plans had an evaluation of carbon capture and storage. You may be aware that this committee took an evidence session just last week. And, you know, one of the messages is if you want to get on with this, you have to get on with it quickly. And clearly the ACOM project being put on the reserve list as questions. So what does that mean for Scotland's target, and can you maybe express you from the committee as to what needs done about carbon capture and storage in Scotland? And if we haven't got that in the time that's required, is it possible that the emissions removals and reductions that can be achieved through other action on peatland or diet or aviation, for example, can that compensate for that lack of progress if it's delayed beyond a meaningful implementation date? Chris, can I come to you first, and then Professor Bell, if he wants to come in.
Thanks, Mrs. Love. Yeah, this is obviously one of the most difficult areas, most controversial areas, I think, as well, of the present plans from Scotland. The UK government decided not to award what they call Track 1 status to the ACORN carbon capture and storage cluster, which I'm certain you will have taken evidence on already. The Scottish Government's plans by 2030 nevertheless have a lot of what we call engineered greenhouse gas removals in there. So that relies on this carbon capture and storage stuff being available in Scotland by 2030. So we're in kind of squeaky bum time, if I can put it in Alec Ferguson language, because this decision on whether the CCS facility will go ahead is going to have a major impact on the achievement of that 2030 target if the plans from at present Scottish Government remain the same. So we've talked about that in this report. I think it's important to say that the ACORN project is not dead, not by any stretch. In fact, I think it's a really important project, which I'm sure will have its route to market as soon as possible. But it was up against two very, very good projects in the north of England, and the Prime Minister had promised to support two. So it is on us with a reserve list. I think it is a very, very good project. The question is not whether it should be developed, it's whether it will be available on time to make the impact that Scottish ministers would like it to have in the climate change plan update. For me, I think we need to be pressing all the buttons that we can try and make that project one that can join the two projects in the north of England and find its way to financial close. That would be the best outcome. If that happens, then I think there's still a question of whether the greenhouse gas removals will be available at the quantity rather that British ministers would like them to be available. Even if they're not, we still need to keep pressing on with this. I think there is a real risk, however, that Scotland might not be able to rely on those greenhouse gas removals that I talked about with carbon capture and storage. If that's the case, we need a clear decision from ministers. And that's the point we make in this report, that a recommendation is that we identify a cut-off point for a decision, which we've said should be 2023 at the very latest, beyond which we'll have to look to other areas. And you mentioned them, Ms. Hislop, in your question. Those areas tend to be areas that where you can make a more immediate reduction, so peatland restoration, changes in the nation's behaviour or diet is one of the obvious areas where you can do something to try and impact on emissions reduction. And we talked about some of the other areas already, aviation, potentially industry. I think it's, to answer the final part of your question, I think it is possible to replace the lost greenhouse gas removals that are in the plan at the moment for 2030, but it's really difficult. And we've already got a really difficult, challenging plan. And this inertia that Keith talked about in his last question, his point is you can't just turn these things on. You've got to kind of scale up to delivering these things. It means that we're really up against the clock, hence the decision point in 2023.
So, Professor Bell, have you got anything to add to that? And I've got another very short question to pose.
I mean, all of that's very sensible, but I think the engineered removals risk is the single kind of most obvious risk. You know, there's a big project, a big investment. There's a kind of, you know, key decision-making process that does sit in London, though it also depends on investment from within Scotland. There's a whole number of pieces that come into play, but certainly the single most obvious one. The broader point is that there are risks across the whole plan, actually, and that having kind of contingency or kind of ramping up some of the other things that Chris talked about, they are kind of sensible to do anyway, and you know, should not be neglected. And this kind of profiling as well, in terms of through time, the kind of ramping up. But similarly, when you get through towards 2030, there's no kind of hard stop, or there shouldn't be, or there needn't be. So it's a bit of, I think it's a bit of a modelling artifact. But if you look in the kind of profiles that are part of the climate change plan update, some of these sectors, like the transport sector reductions or in buildings, the reductions suddenly stop in sort of 2028 or 2029. Well, that shouldn't be happening in reality. You've already built up a sector and a whole kind of, I talked about it earlier, skills base, and you've also got other room to go in terms of, you know, number of buildings to go through. You would expect that kind of effort to continue, even if as you get through the whole kind of stock, the kind of rate at which you're doing things kind of gradually slows down. But that's all part of a just transition, actually, because enabling people to get into other sectors, but also the kind of graceful exit as the kind of need and the demand kind of slightly kind of settles down, and then you're more into a kind of a turnover and maintenance type of cycle. So anyway, it's just, the risks are there across the board and need to be kind of carefully managed.
Thank you. And finally, I just want to ask about cement. We were told as MSPs recently that if cement was a country, it would be third after the US and China in terms of its global emissions. And we've also heard in evidence to this committee about the potential role of carbon capture, utilisation and storage in relation to cement. And is that something that, in terms of the innovation or different aspects, need to be given more focus? And particularly, Chris Stark, if I can come to you, in terms of that wall of capital, we know that wall of capital is interested in probably the most obvious and exciting of investments, particularly energy, for example. But potentially we should be looking, renewable energy as in generation, but potentially should we be looking at some of the unsexy subjects like cement to try and look at what we can try and do if we're going to, the message we're hearing is we have to do more of everything rather than necessarily just do one thing. So Chris, can I maybe come to you and Camilla can let us know time-wise if we can come to Professor Bell. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, I find cement tremendously sexy, so I think there's no issue. I think we should be talking about that, because I think these are the kind of topics that really do matter. That point you raised in your question is absolutely right. cement is, perhaps along with steel, is the kind of basis of global infrastructure. Throughout the world, it's a measure of how developed an economy is, and you need it. And there are ways to develop zero carbon steel and cement. It rests on a combination of things: a switch in the fuels that we use in industry, and probably the use of carbon capture as well. And it takes us into a different sort of discussion about how to decarbonize the economy, which is really the kind of grand next stage for me in this plan. We've talked mostly in the last 10, 15 years about how to decarbonize the power sector. Well, that's done now in Scotland. We've got a massive task still to grow the size of renewable supply that is going to be generated in Scotland. But the task of actually decarbonizing is by and large done. We need to move on to the next set of challenges, and looming large in amongst those challenges is what we call industry emissions, and cement is in there. I just give you a sense of that. Every 5 years, we give advice on a new set of climate targets across the whole of the UK, including for Scotland. And we did so last December, a year ago. And in that advice, we really, really looked hard at the industry questions. And just to give you a measure of this, 5 years ago, we advised a 2030 target. 5 years later, we've dialed up the ambition because we now have a net zero goal. And we've looked again at that 2030 target. 75% of the change in the 2030 target comes from a different outlook from the CCC on how to decarbonize industry. So these kind of heavy industries, as they're sometimes called, including cement, we see much more opportunity to decarbonize them than we did in previous assessments. That's because we can see now a path to fuel switching, as we call it, to using electricity more extensively in those industries, and also to doing using things like hydrogen and carbon capture. So I would love to see Scotland take a lead on that, because it's going to help immensely in the achievement of these targets. But crucially, never mind the targets, this is a source of future industrial success for a country like Scotland, and with it, economic success and jobs. So I think it's a feature of the fact that Scotland has these more ambitious targets in the short term than the rest of the UK, that it can specialise in some of these aspects of the transition. And there are places at the moment which pump out lots of carbon dioxide in the production of cement. Places like in Dunbar, I believe, there's a cement facility. They can be decarbonised, and it's really important that they are. So for me, this is exciting stuff, and I would like to see us talk more about that, actually. And it's one of the reasons why I've raised now a few times the lack of ambition, we think, in the Scottish Government's industry plans.
Thanks very much, Chris. I'll hand back now to the convener to direct the questioning. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Fiona. Let me bring in Liam Kerr to be followed by Mark Ruskell. Liam, over to you.
Very grateful, convener. Good morning, gentlemen. Picking up on your progress report, you said you weren't able to establish how policies and proposals in the climate change plan update add up to the required emissions reductions. Does the Scottish Government now have the right tools and models to quantify how the policies that you've talked about add up to the required emissions reductions? Chris Stark.
I think they do have the tools to do this, and it was a conscious decision to flag this difficulty that we've had in understanding the gap between the modelled pathways and the policies. So what we have in the Climate Change Plan update is a set of modelled sectoral pathways for emissions reduction. We've talked about them a few times already, but I don't mind talking about them again, because they are produced by the Scottish Government's Times model. And it looks to us like the Times model has had steam coming out the side in producing these sectoral pathways. It has been unable to produce what look like kind of smooth pathways to the 2030 target and beyond. Lots of what we call off-model adjustments clearly have been made in a range of sectors. So there's a kind of an issue there with the modelling of these pathways, a collection of quite odd trajectories for those sectoral emissions that Keith has already mentioned, where it appears that the Times model just hasn't coped. So we see a really sharp decline in the early part of the coming decade, and then a strange plateau or a straight line in some of the sectors. Clearly, as the model has decided that it should switch to another sector to find cheaper emissions reductions somewhere else. That's not the way the real world works. So if you work really hard to decarbonize, say, the buildings sector, then you wouldn't stop at some point during this decade, you would carry on. You would have supply chains out there in the real world continuing to do that work. So, you know, there's a kind of modelling issue there. And then the other transparency issue, if I can put it that way, is that we haven't been able to tie policies announced by Scottish ministers to the pathways that they have published in the Climate Change Plan update. Now, there's a degree to which that must always be the case. So, you know, I would always expect a sort of slightly incomplete policy package, because you want a pathway out into the future, and the further out into the future that you go, the less sure you are of what policy will deliver. So I'm perfectly happy with that. But we've got quite a gap now between the stated ambition for policy, best we can see it, and those model pathways. Now, that's the gap I'd like to see closed. So I'd like to understand better what the list of announcements that has been made by Scottish ministers will actually deliver, or what they expect it to deliver in greenhouse gas terms, and crucially, how those policies will be funded and delivered on the ground. And then we can start to wed this together a little more. And that was what we flagged, essentially. Now, I think they have the tools to do all of that, but they have chosen, for whatever reason, not to publish it. And we haven't been able to find that information out, I'm afraid.
I'll just reinforce that. And my understanding is that there have been commissioning work over the last year from various consultants or whatever to dig into the extra layer of detail that would sit behind what the Climate Change Plan update was suggesting was possible. And I think that word suggesting is really important, because models are a means to an end. They don't tell you the whole answer. This is a classic quote from a statistician from some years ago, George Boxing. I feel almost contractually obliged to throw it in at some point, but all models are wrong, but some are useful. But you've got to know how to use them, you know? So they help you to understand the potential answer, but they're not the answer. So you've got to then kind of flesh it out and kind of understand the limitations of the model and what it's telling you. And then, as I say, commission more work or do more work internally. And this is where it's a challenge of what is the civil service able to do itself? What expertise does it have in-house? And how does it understand the interaction between different sectors and different kinds of issues? You know, the interaction between finance and the kind of the technology, the skills, and so on. And what does it need to kind of buy in from outside? So, yes, I believe it has been trying to get some of that extra information and buying in the expertise from outside, but that's taking a bit of time. It still needs to be kind of drawn together. So it's a classic thing of, you know, the kind of another kind of cliche of, you know, I wouldn't have started from here. But, you know, I think it's just an encouragement, really, to the Scottish Government to put sufficient resource into it and, kind of spend the thinking time of drawing it all together and then being able to put it out for external scrutiny, because, you know, they're not going to be so arrogant as to assume everything's got it right. I mean, that'd be the same for us. We, you know, in the CCC, want to get things out. This is our line of thinking. This is where it's come from. Draw together the expertise that's, you know, in the wider world. Nobody has all the answers. Very hard to put it all together. So we need this sort of discussion to be going on. And that's what we want to kind of get that extra layer of detail in a public sort of forum.
I'm very grateful. Drilling into a specific area, the Scottish Government recently published its catch-up report, setting out various proposals and policies to compensate for the excess emissions that come from the missed target in 2019. Now, yesterday, and I appreciate you won't have seen this, but yesterday I got a letter from the Cabinet Secretary in which he said, "We are also confident that the additional policies included in our catch-up report will more than exceed the 2.7 MT from the missed annual target." So do you think that the catch-up report does have the adequate policies to mitigate 2.7 metric tons of CO2 equivalent? And even if the policies are there, will they actually deliver in your view?
That 2.7, I'm certain, can be recovered. But I think there's a wider issue about the extent of change necessary to keep meeting these annual targets. And we had a big debate around the table in our committee, the Climate Change Committee, about this very issue. And it's very challenging. They are all legal targets. We have a framework in Scotland that has a net zero target, clearly, and a set of interim targets, notably the 2030 target, which we've talked about a lot already. But it also has these annual targets. I am certain that the 2020 target will be met, well, I'm as certain as I can be without actually having the data, because I'm afraid we won't get that until next year, but we're in the midst of a huge lockdown, global shutdown, that I think will have pressed emissions to quite an extraordinary degree. But I'm also certain that the infrastructure that caused those emissions was lying dormant over that period, and we will see that restarted. You can already see on roads in Scotland the number of cars that are making journeys now. You can already see the reluctance of the Scottish public to use public transport. We are in our homes, heating our homes, rather than being in offices that are being heated at the moment. There are going to be all sorts of challenges ongoing, on an ongoing basis, to meet those annual targets. I think they will be difficult to meet. And we've said in the progress report that after the 2020 target has been met, the next target is almost certainly going to be missed. So we have got, I'm afraid, not a great record of meeting those annual targets under the Climate Change Act. More have been missed than have been met. My own view is that we should draw a line under this, focus as much as we can on achieving net zero on the 2030 target, because there is enough time to address those inertia issues, to scale up the policies, to scale up the supply chains that will be necessary to actually reduce the emissions in the real world. And that actually now is the time for us to make that that conscious move and to focus on what we can actually achieve. The requirement under the Scottish Climate Change Act is that you do have these catch-up plans. I'm sure we will continue to have these catch-up plans, but let's collectively focus on what really matters, which is cutting those emissions as much as we can and as quickly as we can over the course of the next 9 years. I don't know whether you agree, Keith.
No, I think I agree with what you're saying. It's it's an ongoing challenge. The more you get behind the curve, the more you're challenging, as we said earlier, the overall credibility of the forward-looking curve that you're trying to achieve. We're kind of that there will have been a reduction in emissions as we have the continued tragedy of the pandemic. Some of them, the travel rebound in terms of car use is I think very worrying. Potentially a kind of a poor signal for what we can achieve for the future. We can't kind of assume. Well, we hope we aren't going to be in the position of assuming pandemic-related emissions reductions. There has to be sort of underlying changes in terms of how we're doing things across the whole economy that build in longer-term structural changes to deliver emissions reductions.
Thank you. Final question from me, just to drill into those answers. From the 2020 report, you looked at 30 recommendations which were to be expected to be achieved by 2021, but only 9 of them had been achieved. Now, of those that haven't been achieved, so things like buildings performance, sustainable diets, agricultural policy, or partly achieved, such as adaptation, training, skills, active travel, where does your greatest concern lie? And what needs to happen if there's a particular area, such as you mentioned transport, what do we need to do to get that back on track, if that is the greatest concern?
I mean, my greatest concern probably lies in the agricultural question. We have got plans in most areas that, in outline, have the capacity at least to deliver the emissions reduction that are required. The ambition, I suppose you could say, is there. We have changed in very recently, the ambition has changed in agriculture, but I don't really have a sense of how that is translated through policy. So, you know, I'm afraid agriculture has always been an issue that we have, in the 10 reports that we have put to the Scottish Parliament, we've consistently raised this, that you see, if you look at the history of agricultural emissions, it looks in recent terms like a straight line. And there's no reason to think that we would deliver the very sharp reductions now that the Scottish Government are aiming for without some sort of policy shift. So I know there is lots happening on that. And I know that we have a new ministerial team on agriculture and on land use. But that's the area I want to see more progress on. And I don't mind saying that. We need to see progress across the board, but it looks like the area that is least developed, I suppose, when it comes to emissions reduction. Now, agriculture is important for a host of reasons. It supplies the nation's diet. It has a set of other interactions with the natural world. There are biodiversity issues. There are natural capital issues. There are all sorts of things going on here. There's a high degree of land use change required as well. But policies that we have at the moment, even an outline, processes and consultations that we have in place, don't look to me like they will deliver the kind of emissions reductions that are now being projected in the climate change plan update from Scottish ministers. So there's a kind of element of magical thinking going on here. No reason to think that that line will be achieved without some real focus over the course of the next months and years to deliver that kind of outcome. So that, for me, looks like the biggest area of progress needed.
Very grateful. Professor Bell, anything to add?
Yeah, I think I would agree with Chris in terms of in policy terms. I think there's also a big challenge in societal terms, which we've touched on already. A lot of the emissions reductions that we've achieved so far have been really on the kind of supply side, on the production side. You know, for example, through electricity production, managed to more than halve the emissions intensity of electricity production. It's cost a bit of money to get the renewable sector going, but that's had the benefit now of massively reducing the cost. You know, the levelized cost of energy from renewables is much lower than it was when we started. And depending what you assume for the price of gas, it's lower than the cost of production from gas and certainly new production. But that's been achieved, okay, with a bit of an uplift on our bills, but pretty much without anybody noticing. The supply of electricity has been, okay, storms still happen and we need to kind of manage those correctly and get the resilience right going forward, but without us noticing. When we come to changing heating systems in buildings or the way we move around or how much we travel, where we're traveling to, our diets, that's got to engage everybody. Now, on the positive side, you know, we saw leading up to the COP a lot of interest in climate change and emissions reduction and what we could do. You know, the Scottish Government, to be very fair to them, you know, has got a good campaign going. Lots of publicity around this. So the kind of the sense that I kind of got from a lot of people and seeing the kind of participation in the marches during the COP, for example, is that there's a lot of support for this kind of thing. We see this from the climate assemblies and all of that. So that's the positive, that there's a lot of appetite across society as a whole to embrace this. But to get the kind of extent of change is still a challenge. You know, linking it back to agriculture, you know, the land is managed by farmers and all of the people that work on the land. So the policies have got to be defined with their support, and then they depend on them to be delivered. So it's got to be a kind of combined effort. And again, there's a lot of positive things coming up from a lot of the farming sector. So it's a bit of a shame that we haven't had the policy progress yet that Chris is and the rest of us in the CCC are looking for.
Liam, thank you very much. Next up, we have Mark Ruskell, to be followed by Colette Stevenson. Mark, I will hand over to you.
Yeah, thanks very much. Can I just go back to some of the comments that you made previously about carbon capture and storage? I mean, we had some evidence last week in committee which raised concern that CCS could be deployed in a way which effectively builds in dependence on fossil fuels. Just wondering what your thoughts are on that and whether you see a case for like separating out, if you like, the function of something like the Acorn project as a carbon storage system for cement and other hard to abate sectors, separating that out from, say, industry desires to increase the market for blue hydrogen. Is that something that you've considered? Are there some risks there in terms of how CCS could be used and deployed and any unintended consequences from that?
I'm happy to start on that one. I mean, I think there are those risks, and it's not been our assessment that you need to separate it out and treat it in the way that you've tried. But of course, that's an option to Scottish ministers. You flagged the use of fossil fuels, and that is, clearly a very important issue. We are going to need some fossil fuels over this transition. We want to move away from them as quickly as we can. Key bridging technology is going to be carbon capture. The reason we like carbon capture isn't because we want to use fossil fuels, it's because using carbon capture gives you options that you wouldn't have otherwise. Amongst them is the production of hydrogen through the use of fossil fuels. But again, that's another one of these bridging technologies. Energy technologies that, I would rather we didn't have to use, but being realistic about it, if you want to get to a world by 2045 where we are using hydrogen as a supplement to decarbonised electricity in the economy, got to build in lockstep the supply of that low zero carbon hydrogen with the demand. And if we only produce that hydrogen through what we call green hydrogen, that is electrolyzing water using renewable electricity, then we won't get there, I'm afraid, as quickly as we would if we use carbon capture. And there is a penalty to the climate to that. So we actually produce more emissions over the transition if we don't use carbon capture than if we do. So I think that's the key point in our assessment, is that the kind of challenge of blue hydrogen versus green hydrogen is a challenge that faces us in this transition across the piece, that we need to think of it, you know, not in static terms, but as a fluid topic where actually we use the blue hydrogen as a bridge to the green hydrogen, which is where we want to be once we've built out the very extensive power system and ability to generate electricity that we will need to generate all that extra hydrogen. Then we can start to decrease the production of blue hydrogen, and that's exactly what you see in the Scottish Government's, in the CCC's plans, when we've laid out our assessment of how the UK can reach net zero. We have blue hydrogen growing until by the end of the 2030s, and then declining again as we've grown out the extent of infrastructure that we need in the power system to generate green hydrogen. So that use of carbon capture, I know, is very controversial. But from our perspective, what we're thinking about is limiting overall the amount of emissions that we produce over this transition, which is what the climate cares about. And the using carbon capture in the way that I've described actually minimises cumulative emissions and gives you options to do lots of things that you couldn't do, like continue to produce cement, as you mentioned. So I do think it has a role, but I suppose the key point from our perspective is that we've got to think very carefully and in a very clear-sighted way about how we use carbon capture, where we use carbon capture, and whether there's a better alternative somewhere else. That story keeps changing each year, of course, with technological development.
Mm. Okay. Can I move on to transport then? I mean, obviously, it's a very challenging trajectory that Scottish Government have. It's dependent on a lot of things, a lot of behavioural change. I'm just thinking about whether, you know, the right tools are in the box at the moment. I mean, demand management, for example, is a tool to really nail that 20% reduction in vehicle mileage. Is that something that you have advice on as to how government should be approaching that?
Again, this is a fascinating area, because the ambition that's in the Scottish Government plans for transport is wonderful to see, really is. So, really, really ambitious plans, notably in reducing car miles travelled by a fifth by the end of this decade. And I would love to see that delivered, but it is way beyond what we have advised in our central pathway, which is much, much less than that, about a third of that, actually. And I think that therefore means that you need to work extra hard on some of those issues. You mentioned it in your question. Demand management is one way into that. I really admire the focus on 20-minute neighbourhoods, this idea of working local. Promoting modal shift is clearly going to be a big part of that, and therefore the package that has been announced and confirmed in the recent budget on active travel is going to help with that. Whether it will actually deliver that 20% reduction in car miles travelled, though, is got to be under question, I think. And one of the reasons for that is because we're coming out of this pandemic. Naturally, people with cars are using them more frequently when they want to travel than prior to the pandemic, when they might have used public transport. So I think, given that we're still in some form of restriction, especially now as we're working from home, there is still an opportunity to make that point, to drive home the message that we need to reduce car miles, we need to use active travel, public transport as much as possible, and we're going to have to work doubly hard at that coming out of the pandemic when we finally do, to avoid this issue of actually increasing the car miles that have been travelled. There's a set of issues, a set of policies that are before Scottish ministers that would allow that, including things like congestion charging and excluding cars from city centres. And so far, we haven't seen a willingness to use those kind of levers, but I think they have to be in the mix. So I really admire the ambition in transport. I think it would be amazing for Scotland to deliver on that. But at the moment, I don't think we quite have the set of policies in place that would give me confidence it can be delivered.
Okay. I suppose one element of this is capital investment infrastructure. You know, we've got STPR, Strategic Transport Projects Review, coming up in the new year, you know, next year. I mean, I guess it, in the past, Chris, you've been perhaps a little reluctant, maybe in the CCC, to offer advice to governments about, you know, road building. I'm just wondering where you're at now. I mean, given the state of the emergency, given the challenge that you've laid out this morning around 2030, how's your thinking evolved, I guess, over time around capital road infrastructure, induced demand, where we should be drawing the line now on some of this stuff?
Yeah, you're right. We have been reluctant, and that's because every government has choices. And I don't want the CCC to say that there's only one pathway to achieving these targets. Now, we need roads. And I know that there's been a lively discussion, and not least in the Scottish Parliament, about that very issue with some former ministers, so Fergus Ewing making some very strident comments about it. And, you know, Fergus is right. We do need roads. But you do have this issue of induced demand, which runs alongside it. We have good, strong evidence that the building of roads does itself create a new demand pressure to use those roads for private transport. I mean, clearly, not building more roads will have an impact on emissions. But also clearly, it is possible to meet the targets that Scotland has set whilst building those roads and encouraging people to use alternative forms of transport. It's our job to lay out those choices. And we haven't moved to a more strident position on the road programme, except to say that it is really, really, really important that if the plan is to build those roads, that Scottish ministers are clear with the public about how they see these emissions targets being met, and crucially, how they see targets like that car miles travel 20% reduction being met by 2030. It can be done. You can do all of this together. But I think there is an element of having your cake and eating it on this, actually, that if you want to have that roads programme, I understand the priority there. I understand the political priority that is given to roads programmes. Then you've got to work doubly hard somewhere else because of that induced demand that you've mentioned in the question. So we haven't changed our position on it, but I suppose I'm more and more suspicious about road building programmes if they're not accompanied by a clearer statement about how you manage these major challenges that we've already talked about.
I think thanks, Mr. Russell. Yeah, I think it's back to the demand question again. You know, how is that demand being encouraged or discouraged? And are you providing, you know, in this respect of you know, car travel, for example, are you providing an easy alternative? And there's definitely an important role for government there. I think in respect of any infrastructure investment, not just roads. I think we've talked about this in some of our advice, you know, the need for a net zero test. What extent is this proposed investment compatible overall with that direction towards net zero emissions? Now, it's difficult to, we haven't taken the step of saying what that test should look like, but I mean, that's going to be a job for, you know, policymakers, I think. But the importance of that, I think it can't be underestimated. I think there's back to another layer of detail, really, in terms of trying to what should be informing the policy, is to get a better understanding of, in respect of, you know, roads and car miles, what exactly are those car miles being used for? Where are people going? Where are the emissions coming from? What are they being caused by? You know, how much of it is commuting or parent taxi or going off, you know, on holiday on a long journey once or twice, or I don't know how many times Chris goes on a long holiday. He doesn't have a car anymore, so I think he travels by other means. You know, this sort of thing, so that when you're thinking about an intervention to change the nature of demand, and you're thinking about what the alternatives might be, it's not enough to think about just an average car or an average person or an average, you know, journey. These different journeys have different purposes. And the last thing I mentioned here in terms of the 20% reduction, the UK Energy Research Centre, which is a consortium of academics across the UK concerned with, you know, the energy transition, it published its annual review of energy policy last week, I think it was, or maybe the week before. One thing it said was, analysis using the UK Energy Research Centre developed Transport Energy and Air Pollution Model has shown that a 30 to 50% reduction in car kilometres is needed by 2030 relative to 2020, to meet the sixth carbon budget. So they're suggesting that we need to even go even further on going less far in car miles.
Okay. Yeah, thanks for that. My last question is really then about aviation. We're talking about sort of complementary strategies. I mean, the aviation strategy at the moment from government seems to be about increasing aviation. There was a recent recognition that aviation demand, I think, needs to drop to meet carbon targets from transport. So I suppose what would be your advice around what any new strategy, what kind of approach it needs to adopt? And where we should be focusing really on reducing emissions. I mean, I suppose there's all these sort of unicorn fuels, you know, as well that we can put into aircraft. But I just think, given the severity that you've laid out at the beginning of the session, I'm not really convinced we're going to get there through that alone.
Yeah, I would agree with that. The premise of that question is something I very firmly agree with. Now, it's important to say that we often arrive at discussion of aviation as though it is the answer to tackling climate change. It's not. It's a small proportion of total emissions, but it is a proportion of total emissions that we expect to remain pretty constant over time as everything else falls. So therefore, it's something we want to focus on. The other aspect of aviation is that it's driven by, our use of planes, the fact that we like to fly places. The turnover of the stock of planes which burn fossil fuels happens very slowly. So you get these kind of outlooks on what to do about aviation that focus a lot on the fact that we can't change the plane, we can't change, apparently, the behaviour of people in the country who want to use those planes, so we better move to having some sort of drop-in replacement, that is some sort of zero carbon fuel. And I definitely think there is scope for some of that, but it isn't going to tackle the issue. And actually, we come back again and again to the issue of aviation demand itself. There is no specific commitment from Scottish ministers on aviation demand that we've seen anyway across the various things that have been published. We think that is necessary. We've made that point at UK level. We make that point in the Scottish sphere as well. In our assessment, our central assessment, we allow for some growth in aviation, but that growth is suppressed. There are other scenarios, we have some of them, where we look at an absolute reduction in aviation demand. And it could be, as we come out of the pandemic, that some of those scenarios have become more achievable than they were perhaps prior to the pandemic. But you've got to work at that, and you need policies to achieve it. At the moment, what we see is a policy from the Scottish Government when it comes to domestic aviation that we will have fully decarbonised domestic aviation by the time we get to the net zero target. I think that's just about achievable through things like electric planes, potentially through some of those fuels, but I don't know how it will be achieved. A much more sensible policy from the off is to say, well, look, an element of this is going to be about depressing the demand that we have for aviation in the first place. And I think the best policy of all is to give, therefore, a better alternative to using planes in the first place. And that points to having better rail travel, to having decarbonised road transport, as we talked about. But that's the challenge, I think, is that, you know, given the fact that things move so slowly in the aviation sector when it comes to turnover of the stock of planes, we have to give better alternatives to people and cheaper alternatives to people to make those journeys through alternative means. And again, not seeing too much of that, I'm afraid, from Scottish ministers.
And I'll just reinforce the point again about understanding the nature of demand and, you know, the different segments of demand. So, you know, it's a bit of a different issue from, you know, people going, like I say, you know, flying somewhere on the continent once a year for a bit of sunshine, with somebody who is flying up and down to London every week or a few times a week, compared with, I mean, you know, I don't know all the data on this, but just anecdotally, I mean, there was an article I was reading in the newspaper a few weeks ago talking to people who changed their flying habits since the beginning of the pandemic. And some of these people were doing, you know, transatlantic flights a few times a week. I mean, just extraordinary. And, you know, have you managed to do your work without them? Apparently, yes, they have managed to do their work without them. Well, who knew that was possible? So, you know, it's this sort of thing. So again, it's, you know, a one size fits all is not the right answer. I think it's understanding the different nature of it. You know, a small aircraft going across to one of the Scottish islands, that seems feasible to do, you know, electrically. but bigger aircraft, that's not really feasible. So, you know, how much is the demand going to be in the first place?
Okay, right. Thanks. Back to you, Convener.
Thanks very much, Mark. Let me bring in Colette Stevenson to be followed by Jackie Dunbar. Colette, over to you.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning. I wanted to sort of touch, you've sort of touched upon it already in terms of heating buildings, Keith, and it was really just to ask about the real world impact, you know, of the committee and the Scottish Government's pathways for building decarbonisation. So, for example, for householders, for the energy industry and the actual site supply chain itself as well. And also the skills development aspect of that. I wonder if you, and even touching upon public health and the benefits as we move forward, I wonder if you could maybe touch upon that.
Shall I try and kick off here? Yeah, I mean, all those things are really important. A good point about the health benefits. I mean, you know, just to be in a warm home, that is, you know, is you're not suffering with damp and whatever. That is so important. There was some work that one of my PhD students at the University of Strathclyde did a couple of years ago, trying to understand, you know, give a better understanding of the whole challenge of decarbonising domestic heating. There was kind of partitioning, breaking down the demand, and different sizes of home and households in different income brackets, and how much energy we think they're using right now according to the publicly available data. And we could see that those in, you know, small homes, low income, on direct electric heating now, according to the amount of heat, the energy they seemed to be using, seemed to be underheating their homes. And, you know, we haven't got evidence of why. That wasn't the kind of study we were doing, but one hypothesis is that it's because of the cost. So, you know, if you can make the heating more efficient, then you can get those sorts of health benefits. People don't need to underheat their homes anymore. And you have to understand, you know, do the work on the building fabric as well as the heating system. So that takes us into, I think, another really important part of the just transition or a fair transition. Big part of it is about, you know, graceful exit from some industries and getting people into alternative sources of employment and building up the skills that you talked about. But a further part is about a fair share of the costs. So Chris talked about it earlier, about a lot of the capital stock being replaced and getting a timely replacement, a replacement with low carbon types of appliance. And that includes in homes. So how are those costs going to be met? You know, the cost of electricity in the future should be modest if we're making much greater reliance on low cost renewables. But it can't be denied that the cost of the transition into converting to a heat pump is significant, very significant, cost of upgrading your home. So how are those costs going to be fairly shared such that the benefits of improved health can be gained?
Okay,
Chris,
thanks.
What you had to add there?
But I'm just to say that we often get lost in how difficult this transition will be to decarbonising heat. And actually, I wish we were more excited about it, because actually this is the great opportunity, it seems to me, because we can, in the course of the next 10 or 15 years, completely turn around the experience that people have in homes in Scotland, so that we have warmer, less drafty homes heated without the use of fossil fuels, creating the problem of climate change. But actually, that is a fundamental of a big shift that we can see and a positive improvement that we can make to people's lives. And just to add into that, the supply chain to do it, that is the jobs that are necessary, is pretty extensive and will be domestic. And it's much better that we think about that now and plan for it. So we will have, you know, a supply chain in every town and city potentially that is doing that work. And it's so exciting to think that way about it, because the ambition that the Scottish Government has laid out in its climate change plan update is absolutely stonking in this area. And they're talking about cutting emissions by 72% by the end of this decade. That's double what we have in our most ambitious assessment. So that is, if ever there was a clear statement of intent, it's that. They've got the heat and building strategy, which kind of lays out how that ambition might be achieved. There's a big spending pledge as well. Let's get on with it now and turn that into, you know, the real world change that will drive all of that, because it's profoundly positive for the Scottish economy, I think, in the end, to make this change, and profoundly positive for people living in homes in Scotland to make this change overall. So rather than being discussed in the terms that we usually discuss it about how difficult it is, I would love to see a more optimistic framing of this. Now, I know all of that's going to be tricky, but this is going to be the one that you know, this will be the transition that people notice most. The fact that you can boil your kettle now, that you know, any moment you might have fully decarbonised electricity, people don't notice that. You know, that's a great achievement, but it didn't involve changing lives. This does, and actually, unless we frame it up in a positive way, it's going to be really, really difficult to achieve it.
Okay, no, thank you. That was really interesting, the comments you made there. And in terms of like the Scottish Government's proposed policies and spend, so the spend of £336 million this year, that correlates with expected emissions reductions. Is there an adequate methodology to calculate this, do you feel?
I don't think there is, but I don't want to, again, I don't want to dismiss the fact that that spending commitment has been made. So what that's a big commitment. I mean, there's no doubt, no question that spending that amount of money on this challenge is a really substantial thing to do. That will be a mixture of things. That will be about, making homes more energy efficient, improving the insulation of those homes, and then ultimately replacing the heat source for those homes. It tends to be an expensive business doing that stuff. So this kind of public spending commitment here is very welcome. What we don't have, and again, at the risk of sounding like I'm dismissive, I'm not. It's very impressive that commitment has been made. What we don't have is a connection to the emissions reduction. So we don't understand what that public spending commitment will achieve in greenhouse gas emissions terms. I would like that, and I think that the tools are there for the Scottish Government to publish that and make that clearer so that we can then do our job of assessing it. And this is an area where, given the size of the spending commitment, I'd just love to be more positive about those kind of commitments. I would love to assess progress and say Scottish Government's got it right. You know, that's a very helpful thing to be able to say to other parts of the UK apart from anything else. So this is an area where just a translation of that spending and policy commitment into an emission saving, and to put the numbers out there, be clear on how that's going to be done, would really help.
I would just add, I don't know if you listen to More or Less on Radio 4 when it's on, and the host there, Tim Harford, he often, when a number comes up, actually we've gone off Tim Harford since he promoted his own book on one of our CCC webinars, but you asked a very fair question. You know, any number comes up, you say, is that a big number? And, you know, in absolute terms, £330 million is a big number. Relative to the challenge of what it's trying to achieve and what we're trying to get to over the next 10 years especially, is it still a big number? And another point I would make, and something I kind of try and reinforce with my PhD students or when I was talking to colleagues when I was in industry, is a bit of time and effort, spending a bit of more thinking time working out the potential solutions to a challenge or how things might go, can save a hell of a lot in terms of the investment cost in the medium to long term. So getting that extra kind of layer of analysis and confidence pays back, I think, over the medium to long term. You can throw money at something, but if it's not kind of well targeted, then you've got a risk of that money not being very effective.
Okay, thanks. I've got no further questions. Thanks. I'll pass over to convener. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Colette. Next up, we have Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Monica Lennon. Jackie, over to you, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to you both. If you don't mind, I'd like to ask a couple of questions around about the oil and gas sector. My first question would be, are the oil and gas reserves that are currently being exploited enough to meet the domestic need to 2050? And if they are, is it important to distinguish between the new reserves and the existing ones?
I can pick this one up. I mean, we are an importing country when we think about it at UK level. When it's Scottish level, I don't have the stats in front of me. But we are still importing a lot of, particularly the gas that we use. We have bigger oil reserves. It is really important that we think clearly about this, because we know that the problem of climate change is being caused by our exploitation and our burning unabated of oil and gas, and sadly coal in some places of the world still. We're going to have to focus on that global issue at some point. We use projections from the Oil and Gas Authority. We look across all of the UK continental shelf, and they provide us with an assessment of the emissions from the sector, which we then take as a starting point to then assess how emissions from the North Sea can be reduced. I'm afraid I don't know what's in those projections, because they don't provide a breakdown of existing and new fields. So one of the very controversial topics of Cambo, for example, whether that's in the projections or not, I'm afraid I don't know, because we don't get that breakdown. I think the important thing from our perspective is that in the end, we've got to do something about our burning unabated of oil and gas. There has typically been a discussion about reducing our demand for oil and gas onshore, principally, but we are more and more discussing the global question, I suppose, of whether we should continue to look for oil and gas and bring it out of the ground. We are planning to provide some evidence on that in the new year, and we're going to try to take a more global outlook on that challenge overall. We absolutely recognise that this is a transition, and that we will need fossil fuels over that transition, and that it can't happen overnight. But we've also said that meeting net zero will entail moving entirely away, almost entirely away from unabated use of fossil fuels. It's really just jet fuel that we have by the time we get to net zero. We've got to kind of match these two things together. And I think we're going to have a more sensible discussion about the outlook for production in the North Sea. And it is not just as simple as saying that we have homegrown supplies and that we are therefore insulated from the kind of price fluctuations that we've seen recently on things like gas. And we don't have the domestic supplies that would allow that. So we're going to have to come to terms with that, I think, and recognise that although we do need some fossil fuels in the tradition, in the transition, we need to be bringing them out of the ground only when we absolutely need them, and in ways that are the absolute minimum in terms of the production of emissions at source. And that my final point on this really is that from my perspective, when it comes to those North Sea production emissions, that is the emissions that are produced through the production of oil and gas in the North Sea rather than the emissions that are produced as we burn them, I don't think the industry's done nearly enough. So the North Sea transition deal talks about reducing emissions by 50%. We said that that could be much higher. Our recommendation was 68%. And until they're meeting that kind of ambition, this idea that we can bring more out of the ground is worth questioning, I think. So we're going to look at all of this in the new year, probably in January, might slip into February, and we'll do that in a consultation response to the latest publication from Bayes, who have just published something on what they call the climate compatibility checkpoint for new oil and gas licenses. Now we want to feed into that, so we'll do some analysis and publish that in the new year.
Okay, thank you. And you just touched on the new licenses and the climate compatibility checkpoints. Can I ask you, do you think that the existing licenses that haven't been developed should also be subject to those checkpoints?
This is an area we're going to look at, and my own view on this is that given that we don't know what's in the baseline, we should be thinking more about, you know, the central issue of what's put into the air. You know, that's what matters in the end. That's the problem. So I don't make much of a distinction between new licenses for new fields and licenses that have been granted but fields that haven't yet been consented. In the end, I think what matters is the greenhouse gas emissions that are produced. Now, we'll do more work on this. So sadly, we haven't got as much transparency on this as I would like. Allow me to eyeball those projects that have been licensed but not yet consented. But that's where we are with it, I think. And what matters in the end is not whether there's a license in place or not, because the climate doesn't care about that.
Professor Bell,
yeah, I'll just, like, yeah, sorry, thanks. I'll just touch on it a little bit to come back a bit when there's an implication about a security of supply issue behind that, about, you know, domestic production meeting domestic demand. So as Chris said, domestic gas production does not meet domestic demand as it is. I think it's, we're roughly importing about 50% of our gas demand, if our demand was lower, then our kind of exposure to whatever's happening on the global market would be lower. However, if we had greater storage capacity, we would, should be kind of better protected as well from global market fluctuations or physical supply issues. On a UK level, we don't have very much gas storage. There's a certain amount of kind of what they call line pack in the gas network, and there's a couple of LNG facilities down south. But the Rough storage facility was closed a few years ago. It was closed by the commercial provider of the facility, Centrica. They argued that the kind of earnings they could get from it, from in terms of the price differences through a year of kind of buy the gas when it's cheap and sell it when it's expensive, but insufficient to cover the costs. I only had a quick look at the numbers, but that might have been true just in the year or two before they closed the facility, but I'm not totally convinced it's been true since then. So if they were, making the decision now, their basis for it wouldn't look correct. So anyway, there's a strategic decision there that I think has a place for government and plays into the security supply issue. On the petroleum side of things, I think we already export about 80% of our production. And what goes through our refineries is mostly imported. So it's the different kinds of composition of the crude that's brought out of the ground. So it's not quite as simple as domestic production meeting domestic demand.
Thank you. Convener, I think my other questions have already been answered, so I'll put it back to you. Thank you.
That's great, Jackie. Thank you very much. Let me bring in Monica Lennon. Monica, over to you.
Good morning. Thank you, Convener. We've heard from Chris Stark this morning that the area that's giving him the most concern in terms of reduction of emissions is agriculture, and we know that the Climate Change Committee has persistently raised concerns about the Scottish Government's agriculture policy. Now, Chris, I think I can see some lovely cookbooks behind you on the shelf, so I'm going to ask about food and diet. The Climate Change Committee pathway requires a 20% reduction in the consumption of meat and dairy by the end of the decade. So far, the Scottish Government has not made any commitments to reduce meat and dairy consumption at that level. So this might work nicely for a New Year resolution, but what action would you like to see the government take in 2022, but also for people in Scotland? What should we be doing?
So there's many ways to answer that particular question, but very briefly, the reason why we advise that diet should be part of the policy mix in terms of the objectives for the Scottish Government is because it is very strongly tied to how we use land. If we see a shift in diet such that we have fewer livestock, particularly sheep and cows, then we can reduce agricultural emissions. But crucially, we can also free up land that's presently farmland for storing more carbon. So there's a kind of interesting interplay between the nation's diet and the extent to which we can change the use of land across the country. The use of land is absolutely central to the achievement of net zero. And we only have a fixed pot of land. So, that's the reason that we come back to the diet question. I think really important to say, though, that there is plenty of room to continue with agricultural practice in Scotland, that we can still have a nation that consumes meat. There is no question about any of that. But without that use of the change of diet as a lever, then we are making it much, much harder somewhere else. You're effectively saying that we therefore need to work harder at some of the other elements of this transition. And we've already talked this morning about the extent to which that's possible. So we're trying to do everything at once. That's the challenge here. And for us, it looks like a gap to not address the nation's diet. And one other reason why that's important is because we know that the nation's diet is also tied to the health of the nation. So actually the guidance on healthier diets already promotes a reduction in the consumption of meat. So we are very clear that that needs to be part of the mix. And I suppose my point here is that I don't know the extent to which Scottish ministers regard it as part of the mix because they're silent on it. We already see a change in diet when you look at some of the very limited evidence there is out there about the diet that the country has by age. So we see that younger people are already eating less meat than older people. It may be that that will deliver much of the 20% reduction in meat consumption that I talked about in the absence of policy, but I think we need to see from ministers what they think about this. So I suspect that there is implied change in diet in the plans that we have from the Scottish Government, but it's not written anywhere. There's no number that allows me to understand that. We have said in our assessment that there is some element of diet change that will happen naturally through that shift in the generations, but there is something over and above that required. But we have stopped well short of anything that you might think of as a sort of punitive policy here. We're not proposing things like meat taxes. We're saying that actually this is about better information, getting better standards, giving the country a better sense of what would help overall, and pointing towards healthier diets as being the kind of key lever here. I think it's that that's missing. So it's silent on diet in the round. I don't think it needs to be. And I think part of the reason for that is this is such a politically charged topic, and it will continue to be a politically charged topic unless we take the sting out of it and confront it and understand what is planned in the Scottish Government's climate change plan overall. I think that's what I'm looking for, is that transparency more than anything.
I'll just add as well that the extent of the charge in this as a political topic, I mean, maybe we can kind of discharge it somewhat, because I would hope that there is a cross-party agreement, just as there is on the overall emissions reduction target, also about the different levers that need to be pulled to get there. So I would hope that yourself would be willing to engage with this as a topic. Another point is that 20% is very modest, I think, as a reduction. It may well, as Chris said, just happen anyway because of shifts in choices and behaviours, and maybe across the generations. A further thing, and it's a kind of recurring theme of our session this morning, is about kind of enabling things, making things easy to do. So making a choice of even if it's still meat, but meat that it's kind of has lower emissions associated with it, making that possible. How do you know where the meat you're eating has actually come from and what the practices have been in producing it? So I don't know the data for how much of the meat that we consume in Scotland is imported from outside the UK, but some of the data I have seen suggests that the emissions associated with that production, say from Latin America, the emissions are much, much higher. So, it might be more expensive for kind of per kilogram of meat produced here, but it's kind of, hopefully, I don't know, we could talk about better quality. It keeps us, keeps the jobs going. It helps the management of the land in Scotland. And yeah, if you're not buying as much of it, maybe you're still spending the same amount per week, but you're getting hopefully better quality stuff. I mean, this is sort of an easy thing to say, but maybe a bit more difficult to sort of help people to kind of adopt in practice. People are more interested in the provenance of food now, and that's good. Again, it seems to be pockets of people. Make that easy for everybody. Make these choices. It's very difficult, in my experience, to find all of the ingredients in an Otto Lenghi cookbook, like is on the shelf behind Chris. But we want to make it easy to find, kind of low emissions food, whether it's our kind of bit of meat that we enjoy a couple of times a week, but also in terms of the kind of plant-based products, what are the emissions associated with that, and what kind of recipes we can use and adopt that are easy and satisfying and fun to eat and healthy.
Thank you, Professor Bell. I think we're making everyone hungry, as it's almost lunchtime, but as someone who's been vegetarian for almost 30 years, it's certainly a lot easier to be veggie now, but I haven't gone fully vegan. But really interesting to see some of the recommendations from the Citizens Assembly, the Children's Parliament, so there's a shift there. I wonder if you can say more about what the Scottish Government should do and could do to have a more integrated approach in terms of land use, agriculture and forestry, and also if you've had a look at the draft National Planning Framework 4 that's out for consultation, are there any opportunities in there that are not being fully realised at the moment?
That's a great question. I think this idea of being more integrated and an outlook about how we use land, agriculture, nature, I think we need to bring that together. That's a challenge that we in the CCC recognise as well. So we in the CCC are tasked with not just looking at how you reduce emissions, we're talking about today, but also how well adapted we are to the change in the climate. And actually, that's another integrated challenge, and it's particularly obvious when you think about nature and land, that we've got to address these things together. So we are on a bit of a journey ourselves, actually, to be more integrated in our outlook about these things. And you throw biodiversity into the mix. We have a ministerial portfolio that covers biodiversity explicitly now. These are the challenges that we see. And it's very unlike the energy challenge. Because energy, you know, not to say that we've solved the energy challenges, but we've got a heck of a lot of analysis now that points to meaningful strategies for how you tackle the energy challenges, by extension transport as well. All the things that sit there tend to be well considered. This is a much more organic, in all senses of that word, challenge, and much bigger challenge overall. And I think we need to be better advising on it. And there's a set of lifestyle issues in this too, which I think is often where, you know, our advice in the past has foundered politically, because we need to understand that there are really important lifestyles and trades and skills that are across this country, particularly in Scotland, that are unique to this country. And I think it's quite right that we try and defend them. My own view on this is that we can do all of this together. There is no barrier to that. For example, in our assessment, when we've looked at achieving net zero, we are maintaining the amount of food that's produced across the country. We're just changing the mix of food that's produced. That's you know, it happens to be you can have more land to store carbon if you have reduced numbers of livestock. When we look at what the Scottish Government has done, I think it's the policies that we see for agriculture are vague. We have a lot of doubt about whether they're going to actually be enough to drive that necessary emissions reduction that we talked about. Emissions, I've mentioned this already, I don't mind saying it again, emissions from agriculture have been pretty stable in Scotland, particularly over the last decade or so. It's a difficult sector to decarbonise. It requires proper forward planning if we're going to see the results that we need to see. And they now have a much more ambitious pathway from Scottish ministers. So I don't know how those two things will be connected together. But at the heart of it is a much needed post-cap agriculture strategy. So we are now out of the requirement to have the common agricultural policy govern how we support farmers. That is a big opportunity to change. The climate change plan update doesn't really make any significant advances on that topic. It's still a kind of strategy in development. Now, I'm sure that can be addressed. And I certainly have had sense from my own engagement with Scottish ministers that they want to address it, and that's great. But it will require a lot of change very quickly. And we have something called the Agricultural Transformation Programme from the Scottish Government, which is going to help, I hope, but it doesn't look like it's going to be there on time. You know, the earliest that we might see reforms to agricultural policy is probably 2023. In implementation, it's more likely 2025. So I don't understand how you get to the kind of pathway that the Scottish Government has laid out for us for agricultural emissions, unless you're bringing in some of the issues we've already talked about low carbon diets, or being more active in pushing the idea of releasing what's presently farmland and moving it into carbon sequestration, agroforestry. I'm afraid we just don't have that kind of clarity, and therefore I am doubtful that that is really the plan over the course of the early part of this decade. So it may be that we get there in the end, but you know, the targets that have been set are law and they are relentless. They say that you've got to meet these emissions reductions by 2030, and we've already talked about the annual targets along the way. They are very difficult to meet. And they're particularly difficult to meet if you haven't got a land use strategy and agriculture strategy that's wedded to them. And I don't think we do at the moment. So overall, we see that the climate change plan is pretty light on intervention in this area. And everything looks like it's in the latter half of this decade. That is not going to cut it for these emissions targets. So we need a better, more robust plan, one that provides much more clarity and one which has sooner action. And that, for me, is the challenge, I think. And we've been making that point consistently now in all of the assessments that we've offered to the Scottish Parliament. We haven't, I'm afraid, had it acted upon.
One thing I would add in very briefly, I think you made a great reference there to the National Planning Framework. Really, really important thing. I'm sorry, I've not made time to look at what it's looking at and what it's going to contain. But it's a kind of... Yeah, very unsexy thing. We talked about, you know, things that were, but this is probably not, because there's a lot of important detail that underpins so many different sectors in the way that land is used. And One thing we haven't talked about very much, I think Chris just touched on it very briefly in his remarks just now, is about adaptation, being adapted to the climate change that is already happening. So, you know, one possible way of doing this is, you know, the things that are coming forward for planning approval, is the proposed development, whatever it is, well adapted to the climate change that is already happening, and, you know, the sort of weather patterns that we will definitely see by, you know, 10 years' time, 20 years' time. And it could be, if we don't have global action in the right direction, it could be even more extreme than the kind of, you know, baseline assumption. So, you know, these sorts of considerations could be built into these sorts of you know, statutory frameworks.
Thank you. That's been really clear and helpful. I know we're running out of time, so I'm going to squeeze in one final question. Thinking about what CCC has said about Scottish Government has many of the levers already, we know that the Scottish Government is a fan of the four-day working week, and there's a £10 million fund for pilot schemes. Again, it's something that the Citizens Climate Assembly had recommended. What's the committee's view of the four-day working week in terms of its contribution to our journey to net zero? Is this a positive, and how should that £10 million be used to try and demonstrate that this could be a game changer?
So important to say, and it's always best to say these things in this moment, we haven't done the analysis on what impact a four-day week would have, but I'm quite happy to flag some concerns I have about it, drawing on the lessons from the pandemic and the requirement to work from home. So it is appealing in one sense, I suppose, to have people at home more often, in the sense that they're not therefore travelling to work and commuting. But what we've seen during the pandemic is that we have to heat this place. While I would previously have been in the office, I'm now heating my kitchen. I'm in my kitchen because sadly my wife has COVID, so she's up the top. So this is one of the challenges that we now have. You've got to keep this building warm, and there is emissions associated with that. The other thing that we see, and I'm not in a position to be able to do this at the moment, but we've also seen during the pandemic that we've used the time that we used to use to commute for leisure purposes. And typically that has meant getting in your car and driving somewhere. So it's not entirely clear that there is a direct connection between the number of days worked in the office and emissions reduction. It may be that we can cement that link. So I suppose in terms of what you might want to do with that £10 million pilot, you might want to make sure that there are ways in which you direct and help and encourage people during those 3 days that they're not working to not pursue that kind of higher carbon lifestyle, and tends to be, of course, a very positive discussion when we do it in those ways. And I think that's what the Citizens Assembly was considering. So I think that sort of idea of focusing the 10 million on a set of ways in which you can try and encourage people to move away from high carbon services and goods and lifestyles over those extra days of leisure that we have would be a really good use of the pilot money.
And what days of leisure? I mean, there's all sorts of other things connected in with this, you know, like, you know, people have got responsibilities at home for caring for children or for whatever, older people, whatever it happens to be, more scope maybe to do that. So there's a kind of connection there. But yeah, I think as Chris said, you know, the connection with emissions reduction needs to be kind of clear, but there is the potential for, I think, lots of different benefits.
Thank you both very much. And Kit, I hope your wife is on the mend soon. Best wishes to all of you. Thanks, convener.
Thank you, Monica. Yes, likewise. I know we're running slightly behind, but just one very brief final question. I think it's important to ask, what will be the ongoing role of the committee in monitoring and reporting on emissions in Scotland?
Well, I hope we will continue to provide the service that we do provide at the moment. So the Scottish Climate Change Act makes it very clear that there has to be an independent assessment of progress. And we are the body tasked with providing it. And as I'm a resident of Scotland and someone who's worked in the Scottish policy sphere when I was in the Scottish Government, I feel very close to the issues, and I want the Scottish assessment to continue to be done by the Climate Change Committee. I think a really important point to make here is that the Scottish Government has now on two or three occasions announced that they are keen for us to have an office formally in Scotland to allow us to have a closer link to some of the policy issues, and I think a closer link to the Scottish stakeholders should allow us a better and richer discussion about the things that we've talked about already this morning. I'm super keen to do that, and I very much hope, therefore, that in the course of the coming 12 months or so, that the Scottish Government can find the pretty small funding that would allow us to do that. It is my intention that we would set that up pretty quickly and then have, a richer relationship with Parliament, the issues that we talked about, and a richer relationship, deeper relationship with the Scottish Government too. So that has worked extremely well for us when we've developed those kind of relationships at Whitehall level and in London. We are finding more and more that we need to develop the local knowledge that you would need to give advice on some of the very fundamental societal issues that we've talked about today and in our report. And I think if we can get that right, then that will set us up very nicely for the next decade and more of continuing to provide you this service.
Okay, thanks very much, Chris. That certainly seems sensible to me. That takes us to the end of our allotted time. Thank you once again, Chris and Professor Bell, for providing your expertise and insights in this area and for your ongoing support to the Scottish Parliament, and also for sharing various quotes with us this morning from Spinal Tap and Sir Alex Ferguson, to name but a few. I wish you both a very happy festive break. And that takes us to the end of the public session. So I will bring this meeting to a close. Thank you both once again.